just do what you tell them to do. They don't propose you something new. They don't tell you that there are alternatives. They don't come proactively and take, not all of them, and tell you, hey, we could also do this and that. So by outsourcing and offshoring, we kind of lost that mojo that creates a little bit more of innovation, a little bit more of new novelty IP. Where does this bring us? That in order to survive in this environment, organizations need to become more adaptable, need to become more flexible, more nimble. In one word, agile. So being agile is not implementing something, being agile is changing your behavior. And when we talk about behavior on an organizational level, we are talking about a behavior which is affecting a large group of people, which means it's shaping a different organizational culture. I'm going to go deeper to this concept later. Now I have a short video to show you.
But Holland comes in for a pit stop. Time to refuel and change tires. Lou Moore himself changes the tires. Only four crew members, including the driver, are allowed to work on the car. It's a tense time. Holland stays in his seat, anxious to get away. Let's watch.
That get it. The reason why Agile is hard to implement is because we switch the whole organizational paradigm from individual work to teamwork. And when we say teamwork, we mean people who work together for a purpose, which is called synergy. If we don't create synergy between people, which means the value of the team is greater than the sum of the parts, what's the point in creating teams? It's just an organizational overhead, right? So the reason why we create team is because we want this team to be able, through complementary skill, through observing and collaborating, to building trust relationship, to focusing together on a common goal, to be able to deliver more than the sum of the individual. And this takes time. It takes time because we need to build trust relationship between people. And then we tell these people, and this is what we learned from the Agile Manifesto, that they should self-organize. Awesome, right? How many of you teach soft skills in your organization to people? I know, 2, 3, 4, maybe 5% in the room. Why do you need to do that?
Because people usually don't know about it.
Why people don't know about it is an easy answer, Bob, I would say. But anyway, I take that one as a good one, and it's true. What people don't know how to do, because they only develop their functional skill, their technical skill, They don't know how to resolve conflict, and they don't know how to make decisions together. From the moment we take a leader out of the equation and we tell a group of people to self-organize, these guys don't know how to make decisions effectively together. And the assumption is we need to reach consensus all the time. Good luck with that. Then it would take 1 year for every decision, sometimes. Huh? They don't know how to go to compromises. They don't know how to solve conflict. So rather than expose the conflict, they try to keep the conflict hidden because they are uncomfortable at fighting with one another. But when we want to develop synergy and obtain that level of performance, we need to go through a process of change on that level of organization, which deeply affects the culture, the values, and the principle of the people within it, and also affect and completely change the practices and the tools these people use to work together. The Ferrari team trains every day 8 hours. They continuously swap position with one another because everybody should learn what the other do. Even if it will never be as good as everyone else because everybody's kind of having their own area of expertise, but they need to know what happens beside them because during the race, if something goes wrong, the nearest person should jump in and help immediately. Because they are aware and that this is their common goal, the longer the car stays at the box, the higher is the likelihood that it's losing position in the race. So they are directly responsible for winning or losing the race, even if they are not driving the car. And this sense of ownership and responsibility is what makes them committed and make them so committed to that work that they continuously try to inspect and adapt and find a new way to do. Self-organizing team require also different type of leadership. We don't need any more manager who control, who do staffing, budgeting, accounting, and all that type of things, but we rather need manager or leader who are able to develop new core capabilities, helping the team focus, helping the team change, help the team redesign the way they work together, and helping facilitating activity within the teams. How many managers do learn this stuff when they enter into an organization? How many leaders learn facilitation skills, conflict moderation skills, design, organizational design skills, focus skills, and change management skills? Very few, because the history taught us that those skills weren't necessary. And why those skills weren't necessary? Because we grew up out of the Industrial Revolution, and I'm talking about 1911 here, okay? Friedrich Taylor, the Treaty on Scientific Management. Yeah? This idea of the organization as a machine, as a fixed structure with defined processes, a lot of code, you throw customer request on one side, boom, 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 something happens and the product comes out on the other side. Awesome. It worked perfectly, right? There is one problem. When variation starts to become too many, the metaphor of the machine to describe an organization just breaks apart. Because if the number of variation, optional, and whatever, it's increasing significantly, then the static nature of a fixed process, fixed role, fixed responsibility, fixed artifact is just too fragile to cope with that level of change. And so it breaks apart. Breaks apart means we try to do everything we can from our creative perspective to keep the organization running by escalating everything possible. So we have more exceptions than rules, and then we run in an organization which is constantly firefighting and nothing and does nothing for fire prevention. This is the loop in which you know. I work with a lot of leaders since years, and one of the biggest complaints I keep on hearing all the time, they are sucked into meeting 8 hours a day. They're only jumping from one crisis situation to the next. And they do this because they know if they stop doing it, something bad will happen. Okay? I always ask them, did you try to stay home 1 week and see what happened? Did you try to let the people work and figure it out rather than jumping into meeting, taking the decision without letting people make experience? Of course they did it. They work at the weekend also and they give up their holiday to make sure nothing bad happened. Here I have another metaphor that tries to explain why the situation we are in today in many organizations it is like this. Let's say we have a vision within our organization. And we know that in order to achieve this vision, we need to produce certain results. It's a pyramid, it's a triangle. Because not all results we produce are inherently connected to that vision. So we do a lot of stuff, we produce value sometimes, we produce things, but not necessarily everything we do is directly connected to the vision. So where does this result come from? They come from actions. They come from what people do on a daily basis. And how do they decide what to do? How do they decide what is the right thing, what is the wrong thing? Based on their beliefs. The beliefs here is not the religion, but is what people learn to be right or to be wrong within an organizational context. You ever had the experience that when you hire someone, it takes 3 to 6 months to understand how your organization ticks, even if this guy is the best expert on the market? Because he's functionally speaking, technically speaking, maybe an expert, but he needs to learn how you do things around here. And that's what the culture of the organization is about. In fact, that belief can only be developed through experience. It cannot be taught. It cannot be learned. It can only be lived. Because I do something and some of my colleagues give me the feedback, that's not the way we do things around here. Okay, and now you do things around here. Oh, you should try this one. Okay, and then I get positive feedback, and then I learn, okay, more of this, less of that. And after 3 or 6 months' time, I develop a solid belief which allows me to orient myself within the organization. What we do instinctively, because we see that a lot of actions are not aiming at the result, which are not going in the right direction to our goals, to what we want to achieve, what we end up doing is managing the last mile. So what managers do, team leaders do, project managers do, they focus on activity and they keep on budging people left and right to make sure that in some way they reach the result they want. Right? This is what we do. And it worked perfectly, guys. To be honest, it worked perfectly until 15, 20 years ago. When the pace of the market, the pressure we get in terms of time to market, the pressure we get in terms of competition, the connectedness of the businesses in the world created a level of complexity for which the time necessary for a manager to steer the action based on the feedback he gets from the rest of the organization is simply too long. And we get a lot of information which are just filtered out. We don't get the raw data, we can't make our own mind up. Everybody of you who is at second, third, fourth level of management knows this. We pack data together, we provide half-baked decision to the leader above us. We tell them A or B or C, we prefer A, what you say. And this person, I said 10 minutes to make that decision. And he goes like, okay, you go for A, let's go for A. Okay? But without having any contest, because it's too much time spent in running after the problem rather than trying to solve the problem. The problem is generated mostly because we totally underestimate Mrs. Culture. Mrs. Culture eats Mr. Strategy for breakfast. And it's every day. Okay? And that's not a good thing, because we think we have the perfect strategy, we have a clear goal, and off you go, we roll it out, and guess what happened? Every corner of the organization interprets the same exact message in a completely different way. Why is that happening? Because the set of value and principles which are spread within different parts of the organization is different. And what is one of the major reasons why that is different? Because the leader who is working with that part of the organization is influencing the culture in a specific way. The value that the leader propagates to a group of people on what are his expectations, okay, it's not coherent in large organizations. It's a fact. Because there is no leadership circle, there is no leadership team who is working hard to create a decision-making framework which is coherent, who is agreeing on which type of organizational culture we want to propagate, and is consequently working in that direction. Yeah? There's very few organizations work this way, and we all know when the size of the organization grows, it's kind of difficult to keep on doing that in an effective way. What is the difference between leadership and management? Well, leadership operates on an experience level. We co-work together, we mentor employees, we pair together, we work on delegating responsibility rather than delegating just tasks and actions. Because by delegating responsibility, our people, our colleagues will grow, will learn more, but they will feel responsible. They will own what they do, rather than just being remotely controlled, do this task and show me what the results are all the time. Okay? This one here doesn't scale. We need a report, a new level of reporting every 8 to 10, maybe 15 people. That's the maximum we can do. And then we need another level of the organization. Every new level of the organization is reducing the speed at which information flows and the detail that we get. In Lean, we always talk about Gemba walk. Gemba walk means go where the problem is. So you will see the fact and you will be able to make a better decision. Shifting the balance between management and leadership is the challenge of this decade. But we need to learn what leadership means. Because through leadership, coaching and mentoring, we can shape the right experience, create the right beliefs, and increase significantly the likelihood that people will do the right thing themselves without needing to run after them all the time. This is fire prevention, this is firefighting. Make sense? Everybody understand it, everybody nod it all the time. I see this really every time. Then you ask them, why the hell are you not doing it then? And the answer is simple. I'm too busy there. I don't have time for this. Because this year is a long-term investment. It's not a quick return. So I'd rather save the boat now by putting two or three baskets of water out of my hull rather than teaching my people how to avoid that the boat starts having holes everywhere. Because that it takes a long time, and in the meanwhile we might be sinking. So when we talk about leadership, we want leaders who connect emotionally, create relationship, who enable people, who listen to people, and mainly who respect people. Respecting people is very important. It's the first step in creating self-awareness, in creating people who own and want to connect and wants to contribute to the organization. In the year we have been coaching different organizations, we have been observing a typical behavior in the leader. So if you want, there are different types of leaders. The leader who are called expert. What it does it mean? It means they operate from an expert perspective. When we talk about expert perspective, we mean that a specific functional expert within your organization, because he's good, because he's a long time in the organization, because he got promoted already to the highest possible functional level, the only way to pay this guy more money is to make him a manager. So we lose one of the greatest technician analysts we have, because the only way we have to give this guy more money is to transform it into a manager. And then this manager is still the reference point of a lot of people in his team. And these people will keep on going to him or her, asking him advice on what needs to be done. And this person, because he is the expert de facto, everyone respects him for it, is not only leading and governing the team, but ends up being also the one who makes a lot of technical and functional decisions. And at a certain point, these guys realize, well, the only way I have to make my team more effective is that I start focusing on teaching them how to do this stuff by themselves because I am the bottleneck. I can't keep my team slowing down because they only rely on me making decisions or only rely on me solving conflict or only rely on me on doing complicated stuff. And then in that moment, our brain clicks and we become achiever. We start looking at how can we make our team shine? How can we make our team grow bigger, grow more effective, be more independent, more autonomous? Once we get there and we start teaching our team all those soft skills we talked about before so that they can decide alone, they can evolve to the next level, they can measure their performance, they can continuously improve, they can solve conflict more effectively, then we realize the next obstacle in making our team even more effective is the whole organization around them. Because that organization didn't grow as fast as our team did, and so we need to do something for it. And off you go, we start operating from a catalyst perspective as a leader. We start looking what's around my team that I can influence and expose the success of my team is a better place to be, and how can I drive the change within the organization so that every team will be able to experience the success, the joy at work, and the fun that my team has. And then I start operating from a catalyst perspective. Through the research of many organizations, we also found out that the leader's behavior strongly influences the organizational structure, and the other way around. The hierarchical model that you all know very well is based on the fact that everyone talks with a single leader, and this person is a technical expert, an organizer, a planner, a delegator, a controller of the flow of information and work. We've seen that check, right? Old-style hierarchical management. At a certain point, we notice when the transition or the will to become an achiever happens, that leader starts to change the dynamic of the group by starting enabling people to talk and work with one another and collaborate, even though he remains the one who controls the communication. But he starts introducing ideas of group dynamic and conflict resolution. We still have individual reward and individual value. But the person is participating into group activity and is trying to enable and teach the other how to do it. Then it switches completely. This is what we call the enlightenment model, because the spark comes, the leader is enlightened, and then it starts acting differently. And the behavior changes the organization of the people. And then we move toward the achiever level. So finally, I taught my team how to solve conflict. I started growing trust in them. I know they make good decisions. I know they know what they are doing. And I have developed so much trust that I just consider myself a team member, and I let all my team dynamics just develop a little bit through self-organization. I'm not steering anything. I'm not pushing anything anymore. I just become one of the team members. Notice, I'm still the one owning all the responsibility. I'm still the blue one. The blue one is the one with authority, which doesn't mean the other have no power. In fact, in this model, which we call shared, is the first model in which we see a sort of shared responsibility. In fact, we have collaboration emerging, and perhaps team evaluation and team reward. It doesn't matter anymore who does what. As long as my team is successful, gets rewarded. When they aren't, they get also negatively rewarded. It is exposed as a success and as an opportunity to learn, but we are not looking at who did what. Yeah? One of the words that tells you we are still in a hierarchical environment is when a problem happens in your organization, what's the first question that the management asks? Who's responsible? Isn't it? Right? Who's responsible? And the answer you should be giving as an achiever leader is, what difference would it make if you were knowing that? The failure already happened, we can't do anything about it anymore, so we need to live with it. Then we go further, and the achiever understands, I need to start connecting my team to the rest of the organization because they can't grow beyond that. The organization is a kind of impediment. And so what we do, we start shifting toward the catalyst perspective. We become more of a coach for our team, and we teach our team how to measure their performance themselves. We teach them, hey, this is the way, this is the goal, this is the, what we want you to achieve, and this is how you should measure yourself. These are the metrics you should look at to understand if you're getting better or worse. And you can do that by yourself. You don't need me anymore for that. And this is where we switch from team review to peer evaluation and team reward. The review of the team is done by the team themselves. They just evaluate each other, and they evaluate also how good they are at meeting the expectation of the benchmark that they set for themselves. What does the leader do? You see also changes shape. Has nothing to do with operations anymore at all. This is why it's not round anymore. It still retains responsibility, acts more as a sparring partner to the team to teach them, challenge them, question them, and make them grow as a whole, as a team. This is what we call the coordinated model. So the leader is not in the team anymore. It starts to take a little bit of a distance and is not involved in any operation. So if you are familiar with the Scrum framework, this is pretty much, without the blue color, is pretty much a little bit what the role of the Scrum Master would be. Being a servant leader, benchmarking, coaching the team, not being involved in product development, development activity, just making sure everyone collaborates with everyone else. On a team level, if you want, this is what we call agile leadership, and you see the blue color spread all over the team. It means we have full empowerment of the team. The team recruits its own member by itself. That's quite interesting. How many of you have team recruiting in the organization? One, two, three, very good. You had a question, sorry.
I have a question.
Yeah.
What happens if not everybody in the team wants to be, take the responsibility?
Huh? Why would not everybody in the team want to take responsibility? Who has an answer to this?
Psychological safety.
Psychological safety. Very good. Why they need psychological safety? What is threatening them? Risk to make mistakes is one. The other thing is, of course, what we said before, changing from individual to team dynamics takes time. Every individual has its own time to understand that. What's the problem? We are asking specialists who have been responsible for their own task, for their own estimated task, to complete it within the estimated time. We are telling them, I don't care what you do. You need to agree with your team member how you want to achieve a goal. So we are asking them to go away from the responsibility on activity level and assume responsibility on a goal level. Is everyone ready to do that? Probably not. So we shouldn't force people. We shouldn't expect that everyone jumps onto the train. But my experience is if 3-4 people within a team buys this in, they're pulling the other. And if we are good at celebrating failure, as much as we are good at celebrating success, we won't have the problem that people fear to make mistakes. In fact, the only way you can go through this evolution of organization and leadership behavior is by doing one little step at a time. You can't jump. You can't use tools like 360-degree review, which works in this culture at level 2, level 3, or level 4. Because the people will fear psychological retribution. They will fear to be demoted. They will fear to be criticized because they don't yet have developed the open culture and autonomy which is necessary at this level. Make sense? So every organization who tries to copy the tools and the model of someone else is putting the whole organization at a big risk because the culture that is in place might not be ready to accept this new tool. And what happened? One of two things. Either it explodes, or people just pretend to do what you ask them to do, but they actually don't change their behavior because their culture is not evolved enough to understand what that means. Yes?
I think that if people don't get a blue color in this scheme, they don't necessarily don't want to participate. But maybe you can also see this in lots of workshops that there are more active members and more passive ones. But the passive ones, they don't refrain from doing anything. They are very cooperative, but they don't lead. So maybe in this pattern, it's also very typical that you have smaller sub-teams where you have half of the people going ahead and half of them.
I think you are confusing two things.
Yeah.
The fact that I'm willing to change responsibilities has nothing to do with my proactive or not so proactive behavior. So I can be a very shy person, but I can be very solid in terms of, okay, you want me to do that, I can do that. And if I say I can do that, means I'm going to take responsibility of it. It doesn't mean only people who are jumping and being loud and staying in front are the ones who are willing to take responsibility. So let's not try. This is a matter of character, of how you manifest your identity on different type of relationship. It's a bit complicated from an anthropological perspective, but every one of us has multiple identity. And each of these identity is the one we use in a specific relationship. So you are maybe a father at home, and your identity as a father brings you to do certain things, behaviors, that you wouldn't do at work. And the other way around. At work, you have a work relationship, you have another identity, and you behave in a different way. So we are multi-identity beings, and we are adapting our behavior based on the context in which we act, right? And we learn that through experience. So the fact that some people might be shy or some people might be extremely active and loud, it doesn't mean they are better than others at taking responsibilities, okay? Number one. Number two is not that all of a sudden this happened one day and everybody, boom, gets responsible, okay? This is a transition. It can take months, years sometimes, yeah? So we have to let it happen and we don't have to push it too much. And you see here, on a catalyst level, the leader is primarily occupying himself with strategic matter. He's bringing the strategy to the team, he's clarifying the team, what is in it for you, what is the contribution the organization expects you to provide to this strategy, he's making sure the culture of the team is aligned with the expectation of the organization and that the team is ready to assimilate and understand that strategy. And so, Edward Dennings in 1972 said, don't copy the tool, copy the principle. And unfortunately, this is the mistake that General Motors did when they copied Toyota lean manufacturing. They copied the tool, they didn't look at the principle. It took them 3.5 years to implement the same tool and the same processes that they've seen in Fremont, California at the NUMMI joint venture with Toyota. After 3 years of implementation, they managed to get about 30% performance improvement. Then they went back to NUMMI. NUMMI had 284% performance improvement in the same time, and they went all like, oh my God, how did you do that? Huh? And the explanation was very simple. Every Friday, we sit together in the morning, we drink tea, and we analyze what went well and what didn't went so well in the week. And we take responsibility over the Friday to improve processes and machinery, and Monday we start working with a different process. And we do this since 25 years. So you can try to copy us, but we have 25 years more experience than you in applying the principle of continuous improvement. So you can copy all the tools and the practices you want, but you will never be able to evolve as fast as we do. And this is what organic agility is about. Organic is both an acronym, which stands for organizational resilience, can be achieved by growing autonomy in the organization and nurturing an interdependent culture. I'm going to give you a bit of explanation on this, but fundamentally, the metaphor switches from machine to organism. Why we want to do that? Because if we look at biology and nature, there's a lot more of pattern and models that we can use to cope with complexity than we will ever find in engineered system. So if we stop thinking at our organization as machines, and we instead start thinking at our organization as organism, as living being, and we think at the culture and the business in our organization as the chain of the DNA which defines what the organization is and how it behaves, then we can identify some principles which help us making our organization more resilient. Resilience means the organization is able to adapt to changes on the market quicker than the competition. This is what will make you survive, if not thrive. Today are not the organization who build the best product, the one who thrive, are the one who build the product faster, which fulfills specific need. And if the product is good enough, they're gonna take more market share than the ones who are arriving later with a bigger, perfect, specific problem. And why doesn't that make a big problem? It wasn't a big problem some years ago, but it's a problem today. Because the market volatility is extremely more high than it used to be 10 years ago. Means that the market redefines themselves much faster than they used to do 10 years ago. And so we do something for the market today, it may be in 1 year or 2 years is already old. So the juggernaut company, like just making some names, Siemens or Ericsson, yeah, this huge company always have solid market share with absolutely configurable rock solid product in a specific market sector. They always came to the market 2 or 3 years later than the competition, but because of a larger offering, more configurability option, they started gaining market share, and within 10 years they became the apex predator. No other company had the dominant predator territory that this big one had. Now the problem is, like every apex predator, is optimized to live in a certain environment. If you take a lion in the savannah and you have 4 or 5 years of drought and no water comes out, all the animal on which the lion feed will move away or die. What does the lion do? It dies. Because it doesn't have any other means of providing itself, no nutrition. Yeah? The lion won't become an herbivore. He won't start eating grass. Yeah? It's too optimized for feeding on fresh meat, and it's too optimized for hunting. When there is nothing to hunt anymore, because everyone moved away, then the whole environment changed. That's the story of many organizations which have been at the edge of the market. Just making a few examples. Kodak, rings a bell? Yeah? This digital photography will never affect our target group, which are professional photographers. 2 years later, Kodak rolled down the front door and said, we are out of the market. Yeah? We keep on doing printers or stuff like that, but our core business just disappeared. Nokia. Mobile phones are commodities. People will change mobile phone every 3 months. It's just about the shape, it's about the functionality. Very simple operating system. I love the Nokia 6310. It lasted 1 week on batteries. Can you imagine that? Sounds like a miracle today, right? But at the end of the day, it did one thing good, phoning. Already sending SMS with T9, if you think about what you can do now, it feels really awkward. But then, also they didn't catch up with the next technology revolution, smartphones. They didn't have their own operating system. They bought a company, Symbian, which created an operating system. They tried to make it adapted to the mobile industry, didn't work. Massive failure, lost a lot of money. Google copied the idea, but Google is clever. They never do things themselves. They always build a consortium. They put a lot of people inside. They make them work. And off you go. We have a new platform. Okay? We are a network first, a company second. An organization is a network of people. And every person in the organization might have competing interests. I say might, but we all know it's probably most often the case. Because of the way the organization works, because of individual interests, because of other reasons. So we have been analyzing company we have been helping in the past 7 years. And we look at what are the recurring patterns that brought to success, as well as the recurring pattern that brought to failing agile transformation or transition. Okay? I come to the point where we say transition. We have been identifying that there are some tools which emerge and some practices which we call catalyzer, which catalyze certain positive behaviors. And we have been looking at these things and reverse engineering a set of principles which provides a very good guidance for an organization to become more resilient. Why principle instead of structure, organizational model, role description, and artifacts? Because if we want to become more resilient as an organization, we need to keep coherence on principle, not on structure, organizations, and tools. Because if we keep coherence on principle and we enable autonomy in every part of our organization, every team will be allowed to choose the tool and the processes they want in the moment that the need presents itself. But the organization will still move in a coherent direction because everyone will follow the same principle. So we are abstracting one level higher the concept of organizational design. Get away from the machine metaphor, start thinking as an organism. We don't have invertebrates with no brain, we have intelligent people. And these people know what a principle means if we teach them. And if we teach them right, they know how to create the right practices and the right tools in order to operate effectively. So the first principle that we learn to value significantly is the one, the number one, which is called increased cultural awareness and coherence. Culture is a bad beast, we learned it before. Miss culture eat Mr. Strategy for breakfast. And culture have to be lived, cannot be learned. And that's what makes culture difficult. You heard a lot now talking about culture, but probably what is difficult to understand, culture is not something untouchable, it's not something which we can't understand. We can understand, we can even describe it, we can even measure it. But the fact that we can measure culture, it doesn't mean we can design it. And this is where limitation in terms of organizational understanding and seeing organization as a machine is very limiting. We think we can engineer culture, but we can't. We can measure culture and we can use culture as a lagging indicator, as a mirror, which reflects back to us if what we did from a strategic perspective and the effect that we wanted to have. It can reflect to us if what we introduce as new behavior within the organization is actually providing the expected outcome that we wanted. But we can only measure after the fact happened. Culture comes after we change something, as a product of the change, not as something we can design. So what is this culture? We already mentioned before, it's the set of behavior and principle, accepted practices within an organization, the habits which allow us to govern the organization, which happens in a way on the shop floor, happens in the corridor, happens at the coffee machine. These things cannot be controlled and cannot be designed, cannot be governed, okay? This is why it scares managers, because they can't do anything about culture. They can only role model the culture they want, which is very important, but they cannot consciously change that culture. I want to make an example now. I would like every one of you to stand up. It's an exercise. Please stand up. I want to make a demonstration on how hard it is to change habits, okay? So I want you to relax your arm, okay, along your body, and when I clap my hand, I would like you to, as fast as you can, put your arm in the rest position, okay? Your natural rest position, okay? Ready? Don't cheat, guys. Ready? Hey, I said don't cheat. Ready? Okay, try again. Some people are sleepy, probably hard day work. Try again. Okay, good. Let's say around 1 second you get it, right? So now let's say we introduce a different behavior in our organization. Just an example, let's try test-driven development. Let's try pairing. Let's try celebrating failure. Heard of stuff before. Let's try empathy. Tell a guy, you have to be more empathic. That's your KPI. How are we gonna measure that? So now, let's simulate that you have to be more empathic, and what I want you to do when I clap my hand is to cross your arm on the chest, but instead of your natural position, the other way around. Okay? Ready? 3, 2, 1. What's up, guys? Try again. You can do better than that. 3, 2, 1. Come on, 3 seconds. This is 3 times longer than what your brain does on its own, right? Okay, you can sit back. We had enough fun for this evening. I don't need to humiliate anybody, okay? So this was a short demonstration of one thing, which is, if you want to change a behavior, we need to accept the fact that our natural predisposition, which is called system one response, our muscle memory, our instinctive reaction is this one. We don't need to learn this, okay? Because we do it so much time that our back of the brain already registered the movement and it does it automatically. Now, we are introducing something new. We are asking people to stop doing this because it might have some drawback and to start doing that. And what is interesting is we are not imposing this to people. We are sitting together maybe after a retrospective and we are discussing that this behavior is not good, that could be much better. And everybody in the room totally agree with it. But then you go back to work as usual, you are under pressure, a little bit of stress, guess what happened? Off you go, right? So the leader is responsible to watch, observe the behavior which the team is adopting to make sure that they follow, that they walk the talk. If they say we want to do this because we believe it's better than that, then we need to coach them to adopt the new behavior and give them the time to fail and try over and over again until it eventually works. Okay? And that is not easy because we need to let them fail. Stop mumming people around. They are adults. They are not trying. If you want them to take responsibility and ownership, we need to let them fail. What you see here is called the competing values framework. It's a framework which is one of the most used frameworks and allow us to measure, literally measure, organizational culture. It's based on two dimensions which are competing values. On one side we have flexibility and discretion versus stability and control. On the other side, internal focus and integration versus external focus and differentiation. There are four dimensions who determine an organizational culture. Overall orientation, also called quality strategies, means what means quality to us as an organization. The leader type or the leader style. The value drivers, what are people valuing the most, and the theory of effectiveness, or how we will be successful in our organization. These are the story you tell around. There's four quadrants, four different types of culture. Hierarchical culture, strongly controlling, the leader is a monitor, a coordinator, an organizer. Efficiency, timelessness, consistency, uniformity. Makes no mistake, builds things forever. Perfect engineering, okay? Theory of effectiveness, control and efficiency with capable process produce effectiveness. People are full-time equivalent, are resources. We don't even name them by name. It's not necessary because the belief of the organization is processes will solve the problem, not people. Then we move on the clan side. Clans is like an extended family. Internally focused still, growing people is the mantra. We will succeed if we grow talent, if we grow people and competence. We need leaders who are team builder, who are facilitator, who are mentor. Then we have advocacy, outside-facing culture. Very creative, innovative, entrepreneur-oriented, visionary. Looking at innovative output, transformation and agility all the time. Success lay within creating the new stuff before everybody else. Producing new things will make us successful. Market culture, very competing, divide and rule. Yeah? Big consulting companies, you become a junior partner, if you're lucky then you gain more market share, you become a senior partner, and then if you're lucky you become a shareholder of some kind or whatever. Value driver, market shares, goal-driven, achievement, profitability, okay? Aggressively competing will give success. This type of culture is very good for getting things done quick, to collect quick wins from the market, every little opportunity. This is very good if you want to innovate. Both these cultures are very fast, very energy intense, very unstable. But from time to time you need this to make innovation happen. Huh? These cultures are more conservative, slow, and oriented on growth, on growing as an organization. This one does grow through process and structure. This one grows through people networking, communication, and facilitation. Huh? Guess which one of the models is more agile? No clue? That one up there are tendentially the one who embody the agile values and principles better. The good news is, no organization has only one of these cultural stems. Most of the organization has a little bit of all four. The question is, what is the dominant stem in your organization? If the dominant stem is hierarchy, everyone who behaves not according to the expectation of hierarchical culture is seen a little bit as a weirdo freak in the organization. Yeah? So when we talk about agile transition, what we mean is slowly transitioning the hierarchical culture or a different culture toward a more balanced culture, which includes a little bit of market orientation, competition, a little bit of processes and thinking, and surely people and innovation. Why do we bend it toward the top? What is the first value of the Agile Manifesto? People and interactions over processes and tools. Processes and tools are strong here. We value people more. So it's inevitable that the culture we want to transition toward, slowly, slowly, is a culture which is more directed in that way. Okay? How can we do that? This is one of the famous companies I mentioned before. This is Shipgate, which has been lately very often on the press. It's about 180 people. Very strong plant culture. As you can see, this is an actual assessment done with opinion leader within the organization. It turned out, this is about 5 years ago, they were too much clan. And when you are too much clan, you kill innovation. Because the tendency of a clan is to homogenize and converge, to limit conflict to the minimum. And when we want to innovate, we need diversity. We need experimentation. We need mistakes. So if we are too much plan-oriented, we stop innovating. What's the problem? We keep on living on a solid product that we built 9 years ago. How long is it going to last? Even if we continuously evolutionarily evolve that product, how long is it going to last? Not too much. We need to start looking at other places. And so we agreed all together with a group of people that we needed to shift the cultural profile in a different direction. And what we did, we listed all the behavior we want to keep and the one we don't want to keep anymore, which are known within the organization, at each of the four cultural quadrants. And how did we connect to this behavior? Through storytelling. We collected stories from different people, which were story told on the floor, told at a coffee machine, about success and failure of the past, prizing certain behavior and demoting other behavior. We connected to those stories, we collected them, we found out that everybody was telling a different version of those stories, as usually happened. Some were extremely pumped up in certain direction, some in other direction, but guess what? The culture also influenced the way stories were told. And then we started agreeing on which are the story we want to tell in order to foster this behavior, and a little bit this, and maybe keeping that one as it is. And I started telling story in a different way. Story of failure and success. The other thing which helped you start in changing the culture is the ritualization of behavior. This is why Agile works, because it comes with a bunch of rituals. The daily scrum, the daily stand-up, the planning meeting, the open space, these are all rituals. What are rituals? Are procedure which always happen the same way. And so we get used to it, but this ritual creates a different culture because propose or promotes a behavior, values and principle of openness, of courage, and so on, which over time becomes part of their own culture. Now we are a little bit more evolved, and we developed, with the help of Cognitive Edge, which is a leading company in the area of complexity, a tool which is allowing us to measure real-time, the culture of an organization and how this organization changed on four different dimensions. And we can do that in a much more accurate way than just through simple storytelling and mapping, which is a very long process and takes a lot of time. So we have went a little bit on machine learning, artificial intelligence, and self-evaluated narrative, which is very important, because machine will never understand culture. Sorry for that. They are not sentient being. And so we can use artificial intelligence, but artificial intelligence is good if you want to find averages, if you want to find where the masses go, where the flow is, but it's not good to find outliers. Because in order to understand outliers, you need to understand the culture. So if a person in a pattern says, oh, today was big fun, and the machine only read today was big fun, what do you think is learning? Right. Okay? So we can even record the voice and make the machine smart on the tone. Still, believe me, today was big fun, and today was big fun in two different companies still means something different. So the machine doesn't have enough knowledge to understand how cultural connotation influence the language and the behavior of people. So principle number one, focus on making culture explicit. The only thing that you make it explicit and you increase the awareness is starting creating a lot of nice vibe and nice question in the people who tries to understand what does it mean to us? Why are we behaving that way? Why are we behaving in a different way? And also, increasing coherence through ritualization and storytelling is very helpful. The second principle, base situational assessment and decision-making on the context. This is very complicated, but I try to make it simple for you. It's based on the Kinevin framework, which some of you may have seen already. The Kinevin framework is a sense-making framework which has five domains, not four quadrants. This one in the middle is the disorder, which means I have no clue what is happening. I don't know where I am. The obvious domain is self-evident what is happening, and we know why. The complicated domain means We might know what is happening, but it requires analysis to be understood. And then we move on the right, at left side for you, on the right side for me, we have the so-called unordered domain. And this is a bit difficult to understand. Unordered means there is no relationship between cause and effect. So we see something happening, but it's impossible to determine why it's happening because it's a complex combination of related causes which generate that behavior. And the other thing which is extremely annoying about chaotic and complex domain is that you can reproduce the same condition again, but that thing will never happen. And then you go like, damn it! Why last time happened and this time didn't happen? Yeah? And you never come out with a good thing. Why are we introducing the Kinemian framework? Because if we want to go away from the machine metaphor, we need organic metaphor because machine and engineer system are at best complicated. They are never complex. Everything we build consistently behaves according to rules, period, including artificial intelligence. The difference is, with artificial intelligence, those rules might be rewritten. But even the most sophisticated robot at Boston's Robotic cannot create a new appendix and attach it to his own body to be able to perform a new task. Sorry, he can't do that. He can just learn to do what is being programmed for better. But he cannot start doing something completely weird and absolutely not programmed for. We might come there one day, I don't know. I believe it's possible, but we are far away from it. Terminator is still way in the future. What is important about kinetic, which is probably interesting for you, and not many people talk about, is not so much the four domain, but are the dynamic. The learning cycle is about experimenting something without understanding what's happening, trying to make sense of it, and then transforming it into acquired learning. Huh? This is the Scrum flow. You work on a product, you experiment something, you go to the review meeting, you understand what the hell happened, what you did, you decide you want more of that, you plan for it, and you do it again the next spring. Or you have a process. You are doing something, self-organizing, you come to the retrospective, you realize, oh, we did that, worked very well, can we do that again? Let me think, what could be the reason why it happened? Oh, we care. Oh, we estimated story. Oh, we took pairing every time a story was bigger than 3 points. All possible causes. None of those is obviously right, but what we do anyway, we write it a nice working agreement and we try again the next spring, and guess what? Sometimes happens, sometimes doesn't happen. So we learn more and we keep on defining those causes. And then once we really get it right and we are able to write a defined process or a checklist, we go in the obvious domain, which is standardization. Checklist, standard. Self-evident. Just do it, don't think, done. Very efficient. But very inflexible. Huh? Automation. Then there is another interesting cycle, and here many people like fell off the chair when I tell them, look, this is innovation, and this is agile. Agile doesn't innovate, only allows you to do evolutionary innovation or adaptation, but doesn't allow you to do disruptive innovation. To do disruptive innovation, you need to go a little bit into chaos. Going into chaos means all constraints are removed for a while. You just let crazy things happen. I was supposed to say shit, but I retained myself. So, and when that happens, you have an innovation cycle, and this innovation cycle allows us to move to the next level. Example, what is still in an innovation cycle? Think about nuclear fusion. I don't want to confuse that. Great, super. This was a mega thing. Innovation cycle, nuclear fusion. Okay? Nuclear fusion, we know it's happening. We know sometimes successfully happen. We still don't know how. And we are trying damn hard to figure out what are the conditions that made that happen, but we can't reproduce it. Once we will be able to reproduce it, we will start the learning cycle. Make sense? When you find a bug, you try to find a bug, you experiment by writing text, by making some stuff, and then at a certain point you find out, ha, with this one, repeats. Then you learn, consolidate, and fix. Okay? There are also negative patterns. This one here is called entrenched expertise. You put a bunch of experts into a room, you give them a new problem to solve, what happens? analysis paralysis. Ever heard that one? Everyone tried to put the problem into their model, because they are so expert about the hammer that everything you gave them is a nail. So they take every problem and they try to transform it in something they know, because they have a model to solve that type of problem, not a known problem. And so when everybody does that, what happens? You end in what is called entrenched expertise. They fall into total disorder, nobody knows anymore what is it about, and then in the end, they come out with experimentation is the only way which can save us, and they go back to the learning cycle. Another very dangerous and painful mistake, or is called what we say, fall into chaos. The bad news is when you fall into chaos, you can't jump back. You have to go all the way around. Through demoralization, experimentation with unclear result, extreme frustration trying to repeat something that works, then moving to something which can be consolidated with a bunch of rules, okay? Take a long time and a lot of energy. Why would this happen? This happens when we oversimplify. We have a defined process, we put an experienced people, because it always worked with us, then there are new employees joining, oh, do that stuff. By the way, this is the process we used last time. What we underestimate is the people using that process don't have the expertise necessary to do that, and what happens? Boom, they fall into chaos. And we are not going there, taking them from the neck and bringing them back. It doesn't work. They are total panicking. You see what is called the RASP process. You ever heard RASP? RASP? Running around screaming in panic? That's the type of process you will be able to observe when people jump down here into chaos. So what does it mean in practical terms? In obvious domain, situational analysis is per definition self-evident. Everyone knows what's going on, everyone knows how to react. So decisions in an obvious domain are simply based on rules. Why do we have to make it complicated? Yeah? You have to submit an expense report, off you go, this is the form. You want to have holiday, off you go, this is the form. Everybody knows what to do with it. There is written your name, I know that. Start date, I know the concept of date, end date. Okay? Those are things which don't require any specific learning. Can be done with rule. How do we make sure that the decisions are made according to rule? By regular review of the compliance, and also through review we can improve the rules. In a complicated domain, situational analysis can only be done by experts. And peer review will improve the way experts do situational analysis. Decision making is also based on rules and process, but this time, the rules and the process or the tools are only successfully applicable by experts, not by everyone in the company. Because they are advanced, they require expertise. And peer-to-peer review and an iterative and incremental approach improves decision making. So we have multiple options here, we want to validate which option is better, then we try all them in parallel, we evaluate them based on a set of rules and criteria, and we make the best decision. This is how you work in a complicated domain. The complex domain is very dangerous and weird. Situational analysis must be distributed. You can't have a group of people coordinated doing analysis in a complex environment, because the environment continuously changes. So what they analyze is already old. The only way we have to control or to modulate in a complex environment is to actually distribute situational analysis, which means, let's make a probe, let's make an experiment. You have an idea how to solve the problem, off you go, you have 1 week to try. You have an idea, off you go, you have another week to try. And what I do, I ask these guys to come back to me every day and tell me what they learned. So they don't know about each other, but I do. And because I am detached, I can see the emergent pattern which both have, even doing completely different experiments. By recognizing those patterns, I have a better way to make decisions. So I centralize decision making, but I distribute situational analysis. Because in a complex domain, I need to recognize patterns. And the best way I have is to do multiple experiments in parallel. Sounds expensive, but it's actually much cheaper than try 100 times the wrong thing before we get the right thing. Chaotic domain, situational analysis isn't possible, as you know, running around screaming in panic. Everyone is busy or pretend to be busy. They don't know what they are doing, but they fear that if they don't show they are busy, someone will say something. seen that before, right? So what we need to do about it, then we distribute the, we don't have any other way of making decision than making a decision. Guys, stop, everyone on the right. What happened? Either they agree, oh, good decision, thank God someone made it, or they are angry at you because you made the wrong decision. Still, you brought consistency into the system. Now everyone is angry at you. We brought coherence back, so we can talk to a group of people and try to build consensus, and then we can use complex domain technique. Third principle, focus on value creation. This is more, is easier probably to understand. Many organizations claim to be customer-centric, but then we look at their organization, their performance looks like a matrix. Ever seen this before, right? PMO, a lot of subsystems, projects are virtual organizational structure, a lot of push on the line to make sure everyone delivers project, everyone is busy on 3 or 4 projects at the same time, if you are lucky. The customer gets something, but it's not really what they want, unfortunately. But who cares? We finish on time and budget, next project, right? This type of organization is maximized, is optimized for maximum utilization, not for value delivery. Is that the problem we are trying to solve in 2018? Probably not. The problem is not anymore producing at the lowest possible cost, but is delivering faster than the competition, because the cost of delay on every market today is much higher than the cost of development. If LG comes 1 week later than Samsung with a new TV shortly before the worldwide championship of football, you know how much market share they already lost in 1 week. It's much more money than the extra week of investment they could have made to finish earlier with their development. So how does an agile organization look like? We don't lie. We say the client is at the center and the value is what we focus on. Then we let the client tell us what he needs in order to solve his problem. We let the client pull, and we create organizational structure which are aligned with the value of the client, not orthogonal to the value of the client. This might mean that our organization is less efficient. 100% sure it will be less efficient, but it will be more effective because we don't wait on anybody else. We reduce the amount of dependency as much as possible. We segment the customer value in different streams depending on the target group we are trying to address, and we work with self-organizing team in every stream which produces the value for our client. Then to avoid that every team reinvents the wheel, we create a virtual organizational structure which are across those value streams, which are normally called the community of practice. If you are a company like Spotify, right, who likes to rename everything which already exists in something different, they call them guild. Okay? But it's the same concept. Volunteer people from all the value stream, independent of their team, get a allotted amount of time every 2 weeks or every week to come together and share problems, share practices, share solutions. In this way, the best standard will emerge, and we'll have a system which is optimized for value delivery and time to market, surely not for efficiency. There is a recurring pattern when we see organizations focusing on customer value. There is a tool we use which works very well as a catalyzer. It's called the Business Opportunity Canvas. The Business Opportunity Canvas is not a fixed template, and I'm saying it with 3 times underlining. Fixed template and fixed processes is exactly what we are not trying to do because it doesn't work, it's fragile. What we do, we create a framework which allows every organization, this is Siemens, this is Babel, this is Sipgate, to create their own canvas. Because what is important is the pattern, is not the form. The form follows the purpose. If the purpose is for me to make a decision and let my client decide on what is the value they want to deliver, I need to answer this question in Sipgate, I need to answer 27 different questions in Siemens, I need to answer 11 questions in Babel. Because the business model is different, because the clients are different, because the decision process is different. And how do I visualize all these decisions? I put them on a portfolio board so I can synchronize, I can see dependency, I can see the value stream, I can see the personas I am addressing on that value stream, and I can have multiple teams in each of these streams working exactly to serve this segment of the market. Why do I segment the market? Because if I don't do, and I leave every team doing everything, the likelihood that I will need 55 people in that team to cover all the competencies I need to deliver value is very high. So the reason why we segment the market into streams is to reduce the amount of competencies necessary to serve the client which are at the end of the stream. Make sense? In this way, we will have smaller teams which are easier to grow and self-organize. And they can be more independent. If we have larger teams, it's harder to come to self-organization. If you fancy growth, I don't say scale, I hate that word, because scale is again mechanical. You scale engineer or you descale fishes. Depends on what you like the most. But scaling is not the right approach. We need to grow agility in the organization by growing the culture. This year is Siemens Motion Control. About 6,000 people work on 395 million R&D budget on 45 meter of boards in three different walls inside the room. There's a stand-up every week from 12 to 1 on Monday with 120 people into a room. They make decision in 1 hour time box. They unblock all the projects which are blocked. They walk the board and they only stop on those projects who are red or yellow. All the green ones, clapping again, well done guys, go ahead like that. Okay? Every time they find an impediment, the CEO is in the room and is taking personal care that is removed within the next week. Otherwise, we are in trouble. Okay? Minimize to the minimum possible the waste. First principle, once we know what is valuable, we can start thinking of making change. Now we understand what customer value is, let's start changing our organization in such a way that will last, that will, in a way, work in the long term. No negotiation, no discount, thank you. There is no other way. We have to do small validated changes. Every time we try to cut corner, crisis happen, demotivation happen, and all the rest we know. Which is what is represented here. Classical project management in change management processes. Boom, 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 boom. Document, roll out, fix problem. 9 months to 12 months or more. Huh? It's like making a baby. And the problem is, when we arrive here at the end, we realize that some of the issues cannot be fixed because the reason why they are there is inherent in the organizational design we make. So the architecture is wrong. What we do when the architecture is wrong, guess what? We redo everything from the beginning. So every 12 to 18 months, every large, medium organization reorganizes. And while they reorganize, the assumption for which they started the reorganization already changed. So when the reorganization is finished, it's already old again. This is the problem we need to face. And the problem is not the design was flawed. The problem is the approach is wrong. We should stop doing this because we try to standardize too early before stabilizing. We are trying to define how things should be before having tried them out. And the all of the like of McKinsey, Accenture, PricewaterhouseCoopers, Boston Consulting, Ernst & Young, they will tell you all the same story. This is the model you need to follow. Everyone in the industry who is succeeding is working that way, or very similar. Huh? Then, of course, you can adapt. They make a nice list of role description, responsibility, artifact, and everything you need to do. Process description, push the button, you start rolling out, off you go, fix issues. Yes?
Isn't it wonderful?
Yes. Looks like, isn't it?
No, it is.
Yeah. I made it intentionally that way, to be simple. Then what happened? Agile change management. How do we deliver agile product? This you should know. Incrementally.
Inspected
it up. And what does every increment need to have?
Value.
Off you go. Thank you. So, we don't design the whole organization. We take a specific problem in our organization, but we contemplate the whole organization anyway. What we do? Because we want to avoid local optimization, okay? A leader or someone acts as a coach, as someone who cares about solving that problem, calls volunteer to help him solve that problem and start an experiment. The experiment is about trying out how to solve the problem, putting together all hypotheses and ideas that people have. Weekly or bi-weekly, we document what we learn. Minimum. Oh, this seems to work, this doesn't. Try it again next week, next week, next week, next week. After a few weeks, we already have a minimal set of documentation of validated practices. We know it works with this team. How do we know it works with another one? Hey, colleague, how about you try this one? We solve the problem this way. They take this documentation and they start from that point until one team after the next, one organization after the next, they all try to solve the problem the same way. They will keep on documenting and evolving until the documentation is good enough. An expert colleague will say, oh, awesome, it works out of the box. That's what we can do. And we went through the Kinevin cycle. We went from complex to complicated, where only expert could use those practices, until multiple experts consolidated the practice into best practice, and it became self-evident for everyone. Small incremental value change through continuous improvement. And guess what we can do with it? Every 12 weeks, we can address another change, or even faster than that. Normally, we do experiment between 6 to 12 week time. If it's longer than a quarter, it's not an experiment anymore. Yeah? It's too long. This approach focuses on stabilizing and allow for emergent standardization. So we don't define and push, we try to solve a problem, and we let everyone know how we did it. And everyone is allowed to take it and try it themselves and evolve it, evolve it, evolve. It's a bit like open source model. So experimentation allows better approaches to emerge than analysis. How do we avoid there is total anarchy and everyone does what they want? If you assume that you are not doing radical change, yes. But if you are allowed to do radical change, no. Because it's like rebooting, in a way. So you are doing something completely different, okay? It's possible. The difference is you do it in a small context, and then you start growing the context, and while the context grows, you have to keep interfaces with the old thing, until the old thing we realize we can't cope with this context unless we change as well, and then the changes propagate. But you try to keep coherence at any time because every small change adds value. There is a benefit. And if there is a benefit, people want to change because there is something in it for me, rather than following a death march of 12 months and realizing, oh, this new reorganization didn't bring me anything, I won't do that anymore. We created a tool, the Agile Strategy Map. It's not rocket science. There's a lot of theory behind it. We have a single goal, a lot of enabling, called success factor, possible success factor, and the idea is through a strategy map we can coherently govern or basically manage, if you want, a portfolio of experiments within the organization without having the risk that everyone start experimenting because experimenting is the new black. It's cool, so let's experiment. But then you run very quickly out of control. So, how does it look like? This is a real one at Siemens. Goal 2015, done in March 2014. 7 possible success factor, necessary condition. What happened? Leadership team asked for volunteer to champion these success factors. The volunteer champion grew improvement team. Every improvement team started breaking down what can we experiment, what can we change in order to improve the organization. What did they do? Created safe to fail experiment, run the experiment, learned, adapted, or discarded. And in some cases was radical change. Yeah? Like removing the role completely from a certain department, using a full cross-functional team. This is another Siemens, same story, strategy map, success factor, necessary condition, an operation board to keep track of everything which needs to be done according to priority. Billy and Nick Wagen, maybe you know them as well. Nobody ever booked a car on their side, probably, okay? Operation board as well. So the strategy map allows us to keep coherence across, oops, that was too fast, across all the experiments running in our organization. And once we reorganize, then we start optimizing because we want to get the maximum out of the new organization, and so we optimize the flow. And optimizing the flow might mean, this is just an example, that we get away from this concept of having all projects running in parallel but needing to release by a fixed date with a fixed budget, and having project manager fighting with each other with knife to take away resources because I'm going to be late, I'm not going to make the deadline, and then you take resources away from one project, then the other one screams and say I cannot make it anymore, then you take resources away from the last project started, and then you try to cope with the big mess, hoping that something good will happen at the end. Welcome to fixed scope, fixed date. Isn't that awesome? You all do that, right? Great. There is one rule when we want to increase effectiveness. We shouldn't synchronize flow which don't need to be synchronized because it's extremely ineffective and expensive. It's actually one of the first sources of waste. If you are familiar with Lean, the 3M of Lean, Muri, Mura, and Muda, Mura means an even flow. By doing this, we create an even flow because we force everyone to work to the same pace, like in a supply chain, rather than allowing everyone to work at their own pace, which is what an agile organization does. And stop messing around with resources, call people like they should be called, create stable team, and let them pull feature or pull opportunity out of your portfolio, and let them work at their own pace. You have something awesome. You have multiple data and variable scope. And you know what is valuable here? That the sales guy can decide to sell whenever there are enough features interesting for his client. He can make them a special price. Even if the official release is not yet done, you can release internally or continuous delivery if you like, if you are in the cloud, and you can release continuously all the time. SitGate release 60 to 70 times a day. New feature. Do you see them all? Probably not. You see only some of those which affect the way you are using the product. But still, there is value. If we make a product this way, we have the advantage that we can completely decouple the development cycle from the sales cycle. And this at Ericsson was making a big difference because they switched from selling meta, and this is a team developing a new device which will go in 60 centimeter, 19 inches classical rack, and is at the moment about 8 square meter of wall with demo board, cable flying all around, because they are testing electronic and electricity first. For the first time, they had a serviceable product. Instead of having parallel team working on projects, one means the hardware, the other one the software, and the third one the firmware or the operating system, we decided to put them all working together between China, Italy, Sweden, Canada, and Germany, and they worked in different areas, and they did continuous stand-up meeting during the day because of the time zone, but they managed for the first time in history to have a new device booting and transferring data in 2 months. That's for Sprint. Completely new hardware design. Not the final form factor, of course, because this mess ended up in 60 centimeter, 19 inches zone, 19 inches rack, but it had already the basic functionality and booted and started transferring data, okay? The same bubble does, different devices, the same feature is developed by parallel team, Android, iOS, web. When the feature is finished, flip the switch on, and when all the platform are ready, then the feature appears. So you can start on the web, you can move on the mobile, you can go back on the web, and you can continue your experience. This is Siemens working on hardware. That was the last slide. This is Siemens working on hardware, and for the first time, they finished the product 40% earlier than planned. Can you imagine? This hardware product takes 5 to 7 years to develop, completely new. 40% earlier is 2 years earlier. 2 years earlier on the market. And guess what happened? Sales, marketing weren't ready. They didn't believe the team would finish, even if the team was in close contact, because we started focusing on client value. The team was in close contact with 2 lead customers, which already participated to all the review meetings of the last year, seeing the product evolve, and their feature request being implemented in 2 week cycles. Okay? Those clients wanted to buy the product, but the sales didn't even have a price tag for it. It took them 1 year longer to be able to sell it on the market. And we talk about cost of delay. Think about it. At the end of the day, we have to grow fast, but we have to stay agile. Thank you very much. I kept the time box.
You want to take some questions?
Yes, some questions.
You have 7 more minutes.
I have 8 minutes and 57 seconds for questions.
But no one's counting.
Yes.
I have a... Is this working?
Is it working? Yes, it is.
Okay, my question is, this is fine. I recognize lots of bits and pieces from different areas and different frameworks and there's a lot of things that have come together and are being used as a to build this, which is great. The only question I'm sort of like asking myself is, in the context of, let's say, medical software development or ISO 9001:215, how, because you're working with people like Siemens, which is great, so
yeah.
How does that fit into that world? Does
well,
it?
Thank you very much for the question. It's a very good one, actually. And my answer, the angry answer is compliance is an excuse. That's the angry answer. I'm going to argument on it. So compliance. We worked also with Siemens Healthcare and we worked with Mavis, which is a much smaller agile company in Bremen. They're working with Hologic, with other electromedical company. We have ISO 60 203, 204, FDA regulation, all of that stuff. And guess what happens in Germany? When you have to comply to ISO standard or FDA, people look at how others did it. And guess what the only documented model existing on the market? The model, waterfall. With a bunch of documents, requirements, and all the rest, and so what happens? People think, in order to comply to the standard, we need to do that. And they kill agility by doing that. They get bloated by documentation, and to tell us the truth, every one of you has been behind the line, knows that that document is written after the product has been developed. And so it completely defeats the purpose of compliance. Because everyone knows it's a huge cost to work that way, we don't want to do it, so we do it in another way, and then we produce all the documentation we can at the end. How do we solve it? I'm going to the point. How do we solve that? Do we focus on the goal of the compliance rather than on the way we achieve compliance? And so if we look at the goal of every standard, you find a way to reach those goals in an agile way. At Mavis, we switch from 17,400 pages of work documentation for one product release to less than 800, the half of which was automatically generated, reducing the cost from compliance from 34% of the project cost to less than 8%, which means I have 26% more money and capacity to add value to the product rather than making compliance, which gives me a head start against my competitor. How do we get there? We insisted and we tried 7 different assessors coming, ISO assessor, coming into the organization, paid money, and trying to convince them that we could fulfill those goals in different ways. And system requirement specification became written automated test, acceptance test, integration test, user requirement specification became acceptance test. And we proven that we actually fulfilled the goal better than the other because we showed them live that if someone breaks one of the already implemented specification, we get a big red alarm and everything sounds, and immediately we know who did it and we know how to fix it. But how do we document the process? Because we don't want this standard big process documentation. What we have is a standard operating procedure manual, which is a couple of pages which describe we are working using Scrum. And every team has the right in every sprint to slightly adopt their way of working as long as this way is versioned with all the artifacts they produce in that sprint. So they use a version control system who version the working agreement, the definition of done, definition of ready at every sprint. So we had full traceability. The process doesn't need to remain the same. It's written nowhere. They just need to know on the 15th of March of 2017, when this defect was detected, what was the process? And off you go, version control system, boom. This was the working agreement. This was the sprint commitment. This was the definition of done. And the assessor goes like, wow, this is the best thing I ever seen in my life. So it's possible, but takes a lot of effort. Yes. Or the assurance manager.
Thank you very much. Yes.
Three letters.
That, and I feel that, that from a cultural perspective is a huge blockhead in
it's massive. It's massive. You need to convince this guy. But guess what? Most of those I talk to, they are more frustrated than the people working in the organization, because they are the one responsible at the end. They are the one who need to spend nights and weekends typing in the document and making sure they are coherent, because the assessor comes on Monday. And so these guys hate the whole thing more than other. And this is what many people totally underestimate. There are some guys who want to keep control and go around like, meh. But even at Siemens, which is huge, and there are QA department which has 40 people inside, right? And they go around and inspect everything and check everything. They are the one who says, please, make agility, make our job easier also. Make sure that in the definition of done is written every time someone adds an increment, please update the traceability documentation. That's not rocket science. You can do that, right? And it's better to do, it costs you 5 seconds if you do it in that moment. It costs you hours if you do it every 6 months, right? Because you need to go around and find again what was the problem. Does it answer your question?
Yes, it does.
I can go to more detail, but it would take hours. Any other one? Or we go for beer?
Yeah. Another last question.
You are having the responsibility of keeping me away from my first beer of the
year. You put Spotify up there, and you mentioned also the guilds, and I don't know what it is.
Chapters,
the funny names.
There, yeah, squad.
Exactly. Are they doing anything with this point to agile stuff or not? Or is that
Spotify? Basically, as far as I know, so we started working this way at Ericsson in 2009-2010, so very long ago, to restructure their way of working. Some of the guys at Ericsson, Spotify is the headquarter is Sweden as well, so it's a Swedish organization basically, UK limited, whatever, but the core is in Sweden. Some of the coaches who were at Ericsson went at Spotify. So my feeling, I have no confirmation, is that they kind of copied the model of the feature development center in a way, but then again they copied the tool, not the principle. They tried to build the culture over time. So the first attempt of implementing chapter squad and whatever failed. The need to rename was especially designed by the leadership to avoid that people would look on the internet and find equivalent definition to criticize their internal implementation. So they consciously decided to rename everything because then it was unique and they needed to focus inside rather than looking outside. And that was a smart move, let me say, even if an hard one, because it kept people focused on solving internal problems rather than looking around and searching for excuses to blame why in our situation doesn't work because the other guys do it different. Yeah? And that was a kind of smart move, but was a kind of retrofit. It was not really well strategically planned. But I am not sure 100%. I can probably reach out to some of those guys and ask them. But it looked pretty much the same as we left it. But the same thing is with SAFE. If you are familiar with SAFE and Dean Leffingwell, SAFE is a transitional state of the Nokia Mevo organization. When Dean Leffingwell visited them in 2013, he observed that these guys, because they realized that the cost of release was too high and took them about 3 months to make a release, they decided to make it in release train. So they said, we do release process continuously, and when the release process starts, it takes everything which is solid in the baseline and start testing whatever is there. In this way, we can speed up the feedback loop. The release train was a huge compromise because they couldn't really reduce the cost of release. And of this, I'm 100% sure, because one of our colleagues, actually two, worked at the NIB organization at the time, and they met Dean Leffingwell and so on. Dean Leffingwell is the guy who created the rational unified process, right? which was the other big catastrophe of the 90s, together with CMMR. So these guys actually went in, he copied the idea, and then basically if you look at SAFe, it's pretty much the same structure as the rational unified process, with agile team below, portfolio above, problem solved. Multi-level marketing, huge business.
Okay.
Very polemic this one, huh? Okay, have fun guys. And thanks for listening.
Andreas.
Thank you very much.